state of mind as any intelligent human being would be at this point in time. He's disappointed and he's upset. I mean, we aired out our position on this over a long trial. We had a fair trial. We got to put out our position, and the jury spoke.
Well, that was Dr. Kermit Guznell's defense attorney, Jack McMahon, describing his client's reaction after he was convicted of first-degree murder in the deaths of three babies born alive after Dr. Guznell performed botched abortion attempts on them. Last week, Guznell was sentenced to more than three consecutive life sentences behind bars after operating a Philadelphia clinic for decades where he performed hundreds of illegal late-term abortions. The clinic was described by investigators as a filthy, decrepit house of horrors where Guznell demonstrated very little concern for his patients or their babies. Now some are shocked to hear that Guznell was, quote, disappointed and upset over his conviction and wondering whether he expressed any such sentiments for his victims. Joining me now in his first cable news interview since the verdict, Kermit Guznell's attorney, Jack McMahon. Jack, thank you very much for being here. And I want to make clear from the outset, we don't tar the attorney with the sins of the client. That's not the way this system works.
Thank God.
In this country. But let me just pick up with you there because, you know, coming out and describing him as upset, and we heard testimony that he wasn't upset when he was aborting these babies, and he was laughing about how one baby was big enough to walk him to the bus stop. It was a little surreal to hear about how upset he was at his own fortune. Your thought?
Well, I mean, that was the question that was asked to me, how he was feeling. The honest answer was he was upset. I mean, he had a trial. We put out our position. We tried to win the case. And anytime you try to win and you lose a large portion of the case, you're going to be disappointed. I don't care who you are. I mean, that's just a normal human reaction. I don't think it's anything indicative of anything nefarious on his part. That's just being a human.
You spent a lot of time with him. And, I mean, it's funny you should say just being a human, because that was one of the questions raised by the prosecution in this case, was what kind of a human being could do this, could abort babies that were, you know, 30 weeks along? I mean, these are babies. These aren't embryos. These are babies that can survive outside the womb. Yeah. What was your experience with Dr. Guznell?
Well, as I said before, Dr. Guznell was a dream client. In this business, some of them aren't a dream. And for 2.5 years, he's been nothing but a gentleman, polite, understanding, fully appreciative of the work that I've done for him, a complete gentleman. I mean, he's a soft-spoken man. He's an intelligent man. And, you know, I'm not going to sit there and tell you that things didn't get out of hand and things went a bit awry at that location. But as far as the totality of Dr. Guznell, he's not just defined by the events of 2008. He's defined by 72 years of life.
A bit awry. I mean, Jack,
well, I mean,
the testimony was the babies were born alive, were wiggling on the operating table, were crying, and he stuck scissors in the back of their
neck.
That's
not true. First of all, that's not the testimony, and I can give you the transcripts if you want to know what actually
was
said.
The jury found he was guilty of murder.
Oh, absolutely.
Murder.
And we respect that verdict.
Of babies.
There was eight, and he's got convicted of it, and that's correct. But he was also charged with eight murders, and five of them were not guilty.
But I'm challenging your assertion that things went a little awry at the clinic.
Well, it did, because there was no oversight for over 18 years. Nobody ever came and looked at that location, and things went downhill. I would agree with that. That place should have been checked on a yearly basis.
It should have. That was definitely one of the problems.
There's
oversight,
no question.
But you know what the number one problem was? Dr. Kermit Guznell.
Well, I mean, that's a simplistic way to look at it, and
really?
But I don't think that's accurate.
Or factual.
I do think that, because,
or just factual.
Well, I mean, when you sit there and say that the babies were squirming and wiggling on the operating table, that's just not true. I mean, you can get the transcripts and read it and find out what the true testimony was of the three babies.
Are you disputing now that they were born alive, as the jury found, before Dr. Guznell murdered them?
The jury found that, and we respect that, and that's their belief. Dr. Guznell, in my position throughout the trial,
that's all we need to know. He tried to abort them, and he failed, and then he tried to kill them once they were born alive. That's what the jury said. That's what the jury found. I mean, not only that,
and the jury found that, but that wasn't his defense.
The conditions of the clinic with the it reeked of animal urine, cats had defecated all over it, furniture and blankets stained with blood, instruments not properly sterilized.
Not true.
The difference in the way he treated women of color versus white women.
Not true.
Okay, all of it's not true.
Everything you said right there. No, they found him guilty of murder, and again, that's their decision, and that's what we're standing by. But what you just said there about babies squirming on the table, blood-soaked blankets, tools not being sterilized, is all not accurate as to what the testimony was in the trial.
That so it was the Mayo Clinic.
Not a good,
it, was the
not
Mayo, it was the Mayo Clinic. It was great.
Well,
women had a great experience
the jury
there,
was,
including the one that he was convicted of involuntarily manslaughtering.
Well, let me say this to you. He had over 16,000 patients, and most all of them were referrals or repeat business. That tells you something right there.
It does, and it's nothing good. I mean, the problem here, Jack, is that he was running a late-term abortion clinic. That is what he
no,
was
he wasn't.
Being used
no,
for.
Don't know the facts. You don't know the facts. That's not true.
How did the baby, if it's not late-term abortion, how does the baby get born alive? Because generally, if you abort a baby early on in the pregnancy, it doesn't
you
get born alive.
You said he was running a late-term abortion. There were late-term abortions. He was convicted of that, and they were wrong. But the vast, vast majority, over 95% of them, were all first-term abortions. Very rarely were they. And when they went in and found 47 fetuses there, 45 of them were all legally within the limit of 24 weeks in Pennsylvania.
Why do you keep body parts of the little babies around the clinic? Why do you keep the feet?
Well, again, you're not understanding the evidence. You're not paying attention to what the real evidence was, and you want the evidence to be what you think it is.
Why
but
did
it's
he
not
do
what it?
It
is.
Why did he do it?
He kept
such
it
a swell
as
guy.
All the Commonwealth witnesses testified. Every witness for the government testified that the reason that he kept a few of the body parts, which were feet, were for purposes of DNA analysis for the as requested by the patient's family. That's why he did it. He had 16,000 abortions, and they found two or three feet. So don't sit around and start talking
know,
like he's
I
collecting
know.
Body
it
parts.
Is, it's strange how
true.
I would be moved by just two or three babies' feet being chopped off and kept as souvenirs. I understand that.
No, they were not souvenirs. If you want to call it souvenirs, that's a lie.
Getting back to my original question, why did he laugh about the baby that he was trying to abort, that he did abort, that was big enough to walk him to the bus stop? Why was that so funny to him?
We don't believe that testimony's true. I mean, that's what he said, and he never admitted that to me, and I don't believe that testimony's true. That's what they said, so I can't comment on something that he says never happened.
Jack, I started off by saying we don't tar the lawyers with the sins of the clients, and that's true, but listening to you, you sound like a guy who's suffering from Stockholm Syndrome, because you seem to believe this is a swell man.
No, I'm not saying he did things wrong.
He murdered little babies.
Listen, you sit there and say that they're squirming around on a table and stick scissors. That's not the facts of the case.
Why are you even arguing that point? Let me concede to you then. I will concede to you, for the purposes of this discussion, that they were not squirming around on the table. They were born alive, sir. They were born alive.
That's what
the jury,
abort them.
And then he murdered them by sticking scissors in their necks. How do you come on and defend him now?
We presented a defense for 2 months that these babies were not born alive, that they were injected with a pharmaceutical digoxin, which causes interutero fetal demise, that was requested by the women, that they agreed to, and that these babies were dead in utero, as evidence in the case suggested,
the
and
babies,
the medical examiner also said
the
that.
The babies have rights of their own when they are past 24 weeks in the state of Pennsylvania. It's not between
and that's
the woman
illegal,
and her doctor.
And you should be, I agree with you. And I'll tell you what, I've come out of this case realizing that 24 weeks is a bad determiner. It should be like 16, 17 weeks. That would be a far better thing because the babies would not be even arguably viable at that point in time. And I think the law should be changed to that. I think pro-choice would have still the right to choose, but they've got to choose quicker. And I think that's something that should come out of this. I think more regulation should come out of these locations.
No,
I'm not sitting here saying this was all done
that.
Right.
Actually, I shouldn't say that because NARAL, Pro-Choice America, and some other groups like Planned Parenthood are disputing some of the regulations that have been proposed. Jack, thanks for coming on.
My pleasure.
We'll take in your thoughts on Twitter. Follow me at Megyn Kelly.